Hi everyone, this is the video lecture dedicated for the topic Bluetooth which is standardized by IEEE 802.15, and this is a part 1 of the presentation where we will be seeing some basic concept like what about the origin of the technology and how that standardization happened, and the concepts like the networking part of this Bluetooth technology like PicoNet, ScatterNet, and those things we will cover in this part 1. And in part 2 we will see more details like the protocol stack, architecture of Bluetooth technology, the connection state management, those things. So let's begin. As we already seen that the wireless communication can be classified into an infrastructure based communication and infrastructure less wireless communication, and this Bluetooth is one form of such infrastructure less ad hoc wireless communication. And the Bluetooth is everywhere and it is so much integrated to our everyday life. So let's start with the definition to the Bluetooth technology. It can be defined like a Bluetooth is a radio communication technology that enables low cost, low power, short range wireless networking between the devices. Now as you can see in the diagram that the different products have been connected with the Bluetooth technology, and they are of display technology, and that is you can see a combination of telecommunication industry with the telephonic industry connected by means of Bluetooth technology. Initially the Bluetooth technology was developed with the motivation of replacing RS-232 cable, but then it got integrated with the so called wireless personal area network, and it is standardized by IEEE 802.15. We will see the details in the upcoming slides. Now it's a well established technology as an open standard for communicating and collaborating disparate products and industries. Now with the introduction of Bluetooth 4.2, the energy efficient standard was introduced, and with the support of that standard in 2016, Bluetooth 5.0 was introduced. The new version of Bluetooth aims at delivering 4 times increased range, twice the transmission speed, and is open to the Internet of Things universe. So let's see some details about the origin of the technology, particularly the origin of the name Bluetooth. So what is the peculiarity of this name Bluetooth? To understand this, to understand the reasoning behind this naming convention, let's have a look at the medieval period. Bluetooth is named after the famous King Harald Blattant. And Blattant was his nickname, and it literally translated to Bluetooth. King Harald was famous for uniting the Scandinavian countries, mainly Norway, Denmark and Sweden. Now what was this medieval king do with the wireless communication? The answer is he is a uniter. As the founders of the Bluetooth technology, when they are looking for a name for the technology they developed, they thought that as a king united the Scandinavian countries, similarly the Bluetooth technology was also developed with the aim of combining telecommunication and the telephonic industry. Hence they come up with the idea of the name Bluetooth. Now here you can see the rune stone established by Ericsson in 1999, who is one of the founder of the Bluetooth technology, in memory of King Harald Blattant. You can see the picture of the king with the two hands, one hand carrying a laptop and on other hand there is a mobile phone, which shows the union of telecommunication and telephonic industry, the reason why the Bluetooth technology is formed. Now here you can see the logo of Bluetooth, which is again formed by combining the runic alphabet representing the letters H and B. The runic alphabet representing the letters H and B, that is the initials of the king Harald Blattant or Harald Bluetooth. Okay, so that about the origin of the name as well as the logo. Now, what is the need for the technology? In 1990, which is an era of incompatible standards for wireless technology, and during that time, the different companies and industries started using their own form of wireless communication. Like Intel was using something called business RF, Ericsson was using the MC link, Nokia is using this lower power RF communication. So there was a need of a standardization to avoid fragmentation of technologies. With this goal, the Bluetooth consortium was formed in the year 1998, and initially the founder group of Bluetooth consortium consists of 5 corporations, and they are Ericsson, Intel, Toshiba, Nokia and IBM. And they form something called the Special Interest Group, SIG, of Bluetooth technology. So in the year 2001, the very first Bluetooth product hit the market and the Bluetooth technology evolved. Now more and more companies started joining the Special Interest Group, and some recent examples are the Lenovo since 2005 and Apple since 2015, and as of now there are more than 3000 such companies joined to the Special Interest Group. Now let's see how the Bluetooth, the concept of Bluetooth communication standardized by this IEEE 802.15, how this Bluetooth technology converted to something called IEEE 802.15 standard. Okay, while the Bluetooth was evolving, there was a similar development taking place in IEEE 802 group. They were thinking of forming a wireless personal area network group. They were looking for the technology which could comply with the rules laid down for a particular wireless personal area network. Now what are the rules? That is the criteria for a wireless personal area network as per IEEE 802 wireless personal area network group. So they are like, the first one, that is market potential. The technology should have a market potential where the application vendors and the customers should be available and adaptable to the technology. It should be compatible with the IEEE 802 standards which were well established that time. It should have a distinct identity other than the IEEE 802.11, that is the Wi-Fi standard which was existing by that time. And finally, the solution should be technically and economically feasible, that is it should be cheaper than other existing solutions. And the Bluetooth technology fulfilled all these criteria, and hence the Bluetooth consortium and the IEEE 802 group dedicated for wireless personal area network united, and it formed the 802.15 standard. Now let's have a quick comparison between the Bluetooth technology and the so-called infrared data association. So infrared data association or IRDA is something that is also offering the functionality similar to that of the Bluetooth. So not only this IRDA, there are many existing standards, technologies by that time which are also working similar to Bluetooth. Now what is the peculiarity of Bluetooth? Why Bluetooth is so popular among all this technology? We can understand with this comparison. So here we have some points, like Bluetooth technology is something that is dedicated for point to multi-point communication, where the point to point communication is also covered and multi-point is also possible. But if you are looking at IRDA, it is supporting only point to point communication. IRDA is supporting only data, where Bluetooth is supporting both data and voice. And you know IRDA, it's using the high frequency infrared waves, so there is naturally a requirement for line of sight and directional antennas. But Bluetooth is using omnidirectional antenna, where there is no requirement for line of sight communication. And if we are looking at IRDA, the both devices which are connected by means of IRDA should be stationary. But Bluetooth is allowing the devices as mobile also. And there is no requirement like they have to be stationary while communication. Now the main difference is like IRDA is supporting only say 1 meter range, where Bluetooth is supporting up to 100 meter range. So with this comparison, you may understand how much special is Bluetooth technology compared to this IRDA. The similar speciality it was possessing that time with the similar other technologies. Now let's see some of the technical specifications of this technology as per IEEE 802.15 standard. The first one, that is the spectrum used, the Bluetooth is using the 2.4 gigahertz ISM band, that is industrial, scientific and medical band. And you may remember like the same 2.4 gigahertz ISM band is what is used by IEEE 802.11b standard also, and G also, like the Wi-Fi technology. So as it's a free band, it will be used by multiple applications, right? So that is something shared for both Bluetooth and 802.11b. So you can expect some kind of interference also. Now when you are looking at channel, like in 802.11b, here also the 2.4 gigahertz channel is divided into seven, the frequency band is divided into seven channels, each of 1 megahertz carrier spacing, and the channels are numbered like 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. 78, 0 to 78 totally we have 79 channels, and the 0th channel is running in exactly 2.402 gigahertz, so that the 1th one will be at 2.403 gigahertz, so on. The 78th channel will be running at 2.480 gigahertz frequency. Now if you are looking at the modulation technique, it is using the frequency hopping spread spectrum that you could study in your data communication classes, where the frequency is divided into different channels and it will be hopping from one to another using a spread spectrum or frequency hopping sequence, that is something communicated between the devices in advance. So with the spreading speed, the hopping speed of 1600 hops per second, it's a very fast hopping speed, right? There are 1600 hops happening in second, and it is using time division multiplexing for sending and receiving the data, and it is having a transition power varying from 1 milliwatt to 100 milliwatt depending on the type of application it is used. Like we will see soon the Bluetooth communication, the type of service provided by Bluetooth we can classify into class 1, 2 and 3, and in different classes we have different range requirement, and accordingly it is providing transmitter power from 1 milliwatt to 100 milliwatt. Now the number of stations that can be connected is 8, in the sense we have a concept called a piconet, and within a piconet it is allowing only 8 active members. Now hop dwell time, that means we already seen it is using frequency hopping spread spectrum. Now how much time it will be within a specific frequency channel, so that is determined by hop dwell time. So after this hop dwell time, it will be hopping to the next frequency, okay? And in Bluetooth it is fixed to be 625 milliseconds, and the topology used, you know, it's an ad hoc technology, so the topology is also ad hoc in nature, and particularly here you can see a network formed with the piconets and scatternet, and the what is the overlapping piconets is giving you, and that specific topology, and there is no fixed topology, so that is what is followed here. Now more on specific technical communication, technical specification, like what about the voice link and data link. For voice communication, the Bluetooth is using something called a synchronous connection oriented link, SCO link. We will see more details about this SCO link in upcoming slides, and we will see this in part 2, okay? And it is using something called a forward error correction, and with the 64 kilobits per second duplex mode with the point to point voice communication, they are allowing point-to-point communication only. For data, point to multi-point is allowed. And circuit switching, okay, is used. Because we have to reserve the resources, right? Because it is a real-time voice communication. Similarly, for other data communication, other than which is non-real-time in nature, our normal 79 channels with 1 megahertz carrier spacing, that is 0 to 78 with this frequency, is used for normal data communication. Now, if you are looking at the gross data rate, it is showing a considerable increase over different versions. So, version 1.2 is providing 1 megabits per second speed maximum, 2.0, 3 megabits per second, 3.0, high speed version, that is 24 megabits per second, and version 4.0, which is a low energy version of Bluetooth onwards, it is providing more than 24 megabits per second speed. And depending on the type of transmitter it is used and the type of transmitter power, we can classify the Bluetooth technology into class 1, 2 and 3, where this class 1 is dedicated for industrial purpose. So naturally we need more range, right? So it is providing up to 100 meter range. So when that range is increasing, of course the power consumption will be more. It is consuming the maximum power, that is 100 milliwatt. Where the class 2 is what we are using in our mobile phone, that is what we are familiar. And here we can see a very considerable power reduction. Like here it is only 2.5 megawatt of power consumption in class 2 devices and providing a range up to 10 meter. Now this class 3 is what is used for wearable devices, which is part of the body area network. So as it is connected to our human body, the power consumption is a very crucial factor. So it is consuming only 1 milliwatt of power. So that is the speciality of the technology used in class 3 Bluetooth communication. It is providing a range that is greater than 10 meter. Now we will look at the network part of the Bluetooth technology. Here we have some terminology like a piconet and scatternet. We will see what is this. First we will see what is piconet. Meaning of the word term pico, picometer, like that pico means very small, right? So in piconet can be defined as a collection of devices, and there should be at least two devices to make a piconet, connected in ad hoc fashion, synchronized to the same hopping sequence. And you know Bluetooth, it's following that frequency hopping spread spectrum. So there we need a hopping sequence, right? Accordingly the device will be communicating. And what is that hopping sequence? That is determined by a device called a master device. We will see that. And this hopping sequence is something fixed for a particular piconet. So a piconet is having a specific hopping sequence. Another piconet will be having another specific piconet. Okay. So within a piconet, the roles of the devices are like, you can see devices with two roles. The one is called a master, another one is called a slave. So what is a master device? A device which initiates the connection and determines the hopping sequence. As I already told you, the hopping sequence is something determined by the master device, and it initiates the connection between the devices. And what is a slave? It is one that adheres to the hopping sequence that is determined by the master and take part in the piconet. So something like this. This is a piconet with one master and two slaves. Actually you can have 8 active devices, that is including one master, 7 active slaves are supported within a piconet. And some concept called a parked device also, we will see that. So as of now, this is how a piconet is looking. And within a piconet, the devices are given different roles, like a master device, which is determining the hopping sequence, and that is initiating the connection, and others connected to the master called a slave. And remember one thing, there is no speciality like a particular machine to be a master, it should possess this kind of network configuration, nothing like that. This is something, a random assignment only. Like any device can be master or slave. There is no speciality this device is master, so it is having some special capability, nothing like that. Okay. Now the next concept is scatternet. More than one piconet together form the scatternet. Simply understand like that. It is a group of overlapping piconets sharing the whole bandwidth. Okay, that 72.4 gigahertz bandwidth will be shared between all devices within a scatternet. So this is Piconet 1 and Piconet 2 shared by means of a particular device. Here we normally call this device as a bridging device because it is bridging Piconet 1 with Piconet 2. So this bridging device is a slave of both, but it can be a master of this also, and that we will see. Okay, now within a Piconet, the Piconet in the scatternets are separated by the frequency hopping CDMA. That means within a Piconet we are using the frequency hopping concept, but between the Piconets, if we are looking at the scatternet as a whole, the inter Piconet communication is by means of the CDMA technology, where intra Piconet communication is by means of the frequency hopping spread spectrum. So now we will see some points about the master-slave relation or the master-slave role of devices. As I already told you, the master and slaves do not have any special networking capability. That means anyone can be master or slave, nothing special. Any Bluetooth device can function as master or slave. It just is determined by who is initiating the connection. He will be the master, that's all. It can be anyone randomly. Now a communication is always between a master and slave. Once the role is fixed, the communication is allowed only between master and slave. That means slaves are not allowed to communicate directly with each other. If they want to communicate to each other directly, it should be through a master. Okay. Now the devices in the Piconet synchronizes themselves by the master clock, and we know within a Piconet they are, everybody is following a particular frequency hopping spread spectrum sequence, and that is something determined by the master, and it will be communicated to the slaves by means of the master's clock. Okay, and we will see about this clock in later. There is a very good overlapping between a master and slave communication. They should come in an alternative way. Okay, such rules are also there. Okay, now a slave can be in a special state called parked. That is, it is set to an inactive low power state. So what is a parked state? So that is a particular state where the device cannot communicate to the Piconet. It can only be activated by the master. That means within a Piconet, we already seen that it is supporting maximum 8 active devices, right? But other than active devices within a Piconet, this parked devices is also part of the Piconet, but they are not active. Okay. At any time, the communication is between active devices only, but simply they will be waiting for their chance, something like that. So that is what is called the parked device. And a typical Piconet is allowing a maximum 256 parked devices. So including master, if you are looking at the parked slaves, it is 255 parked slaves. And it is like the active devices will be communicating. Now at any time one of the active device don't want to communicate or it want to take a gap between the communication, it can go to the parked state, and one device from the parked state will be coming as an active slave. So there is a master, there are slaves, there will be 7 slaves, and totally including master there will be 8 active devices, and there can be up to 255 parked slaves also within a Piconet. Now how to identify this? There are 8 active devices and 255 parked slaves. Okay, how we can identify them? By means of an address, right? So we are using two types of address called an active member address and a parked member address. And as you know that there are only 8 active devices, to identify any one out of these 8, 3 bits are enough, right? Now parked member address means it is supporting 255 parked slaves. So to identify one among them, we need 8 bits as the 2 raised to 8 is giving you 256 combination, right? As the parked member address, we are using 8 bits. Now a typical Piconet structure. In a Piconet you can see different devices like a master, active slave and parked slave, and something called a standby state. We already seen what is a master, active slave and parked slave. Now standby means they are not even part of the Piconet. They just want to be part of the Piconet, but so far they are not even part of the Piconet. If you are looking at a parked slave, they are part of the Piconet, but they didn't start any communication. They are not allowed to do any communication. Where active slaves are part of the Piconet and they can communicate with each other in that frequency. Okay. Now the typical structure of a scatter net. I already seen that scatter the scatter net is a collection of different piconets, right? So here you can see a scatter net which is a collection of piconet 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now just look at the coloring, like this yellow color is representing a slave device and red color representing a master. Now a particular device which is given red and yellow means it is having the role of master and slave at the same time, okay? Now if you are looking at piconet 1, there is a single master and two slaves, and in piconet 2 there is a master and a slave. Now one of the slave of piconet 1 is acting as a master in piconet 2 also. That is something allowed. And now this device is something called a bridge device. Now the bridge device is given two roles. It can be master of this piconet and at the same time it can be slave of this piconet. Similarly, if you are looking at piconet 3 and 4, here the bridge device is acting as a slave in both the piconet 3 and the piconet 4. Okay, so it is allowing such roles. Like a particular device can be when it is a bridge device, it can be a slave in more than one piconet, and also it can be a master as well as slave. But remember, a particular device is not allowed to be master in two different piconet. That is not allowed, but it can share that master slave relation as well as slave slave, like that overlapping is possible. Okay, with this I am winding up the first part of the Bluetooth presentation. Now in the second part you will see more details, like what about the Bluetooth protocol stack and different layers of Bluetooth implementation, then the connection establishment, what about the state diagram, and we will end up with a comparison between the Bluetooth and the Wi-Fi technology. That about part 2. Okay, thank you.